How are y'all? Yeah. Wicked, wicked. Thanks for coming, thanks for being here. Well, before I begin, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of this land and pay my respects to their ancestors, past and present. I'd like to extend that onto each and every one of you as well. I'm very, 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 very happy to be back at this beautiful, beautiful theater. This is this is one of my most favorite places on the planet, so thanks for having me again.
We're gonna be the long time. Well, you don't take the ones we find.
it's good to be back. It feels like it's been a while. I'm not sure if it has or not, but it feels like it has. It's a, just a little song about mental illness. It's a feel-good number. Like breaking the ice with a bit of a mental illness conversation. My dad always said. And, the syndrome in particular that I'm speaking about, even though I can't really see many of you, all I can see you. Hey, dude. the one called the grass is greener syndrome. I don't know if you guys got it. I'm pretty sure about 80% of you probably do. And it's one that I've kind of been dealing with for strange thing, you know. So lucky, so fortunate, most of us are, and yet we want more constantly. And then we get that thing, and we pray for that thing, and we work hard for that thing, and we think once we get that, then happiness is ours. And we get it. And then there's just something else. It's strange. It's weird. It's disturbing. That's why I call it mental illness. I was walking past a news agency the other day, and there was freaky looking people on the cover of women's magazines. Like really scary cat looking people. And I was thinking, they got what I got in the extreme, because this is never freaking good enough, you know what I'm saying? Anyway, so I guess this song is just trying to remind myself that it's all here, it's all now. And the most brilliant things in life are your health and your friends and your family and all the other bullshit is just bullshit. Thank you. Thank you. Before we go any further, can we get a big round of applause for Mama Kim, the opening act tonight? From the east of the USA, in particular the Appalachian Mountains there. He's in jail, he's just about to get out, and he's just looking at the mistakes of a young man who he barely knows anymore, and he's looking at it all, sizing it up, I guess you could say. guitar stand, isn't it? This next song is a new song. It's called Kimberly. And it's all about all the humbug that's going on in the northwest of Western Australia in the Kimberleys. Has anybody ever been to the Kimberleys before? Anybody here? Not many, a few.
Well, for those who don't know what it's like,
it's a beautiful place. It's one of the last great wildernesses on this planet.
And I'm just like losing on my campus.
And it's a beautiful space, beautiful place. And I've been going up there for years now. And it's where I got together with my wife. It's not where I met her. It's where I got together with her. This is gas reserve about 300 kilometers off the coast of Broome. It's called the Browse Basin, and there's a shitload of gas, basically. And they being Colin Barnett, the premier of my state, and Woodside, a resource company, want to ship it straight, just pipe it straight to the coast and put up a huge gas refinery right there on this pristine coastline and basically industrialize all of the Kimberley. And I have a problem with that, and many other people have a problem with that. The main reason why we have a problem with it is not because of the gas. We're fine with them taking the gas. It's the fact that they have a huge gas refinery 1,000 km to the south, but yet they want to do it there in the Kimberley. And so myself and thousands of other Australians, along with them, a good friend of mine, Joseph Rowe, who's the senior lawman and custodian of a place called James Price Point. And James Price Point is exactly where they want to put this gas refinery. And Joe's family are buried there. His ancestors are buried there. It's his church. And it's where the song lines run. His song lines run right through that place. And so Joe's chief duty in life is to look after that song line and make sure that the young people can gain the benefits of that song line, and this culture is preserved. And he was given that great responsibility by his grandfather, Paddy. And so over the last 6 years or so, if not longer, we've been fighting Colin Barnett and Woodside, and telling them to kind of, yeah, kind of like, hey, you know, there's a, we can all be happy here. Why do you have to do it here? And then the real reason is because there's so much good stuff going under the ground in the Kimberley, so they want to industrialize the whole place. And coming from WA, we got plenty of holes already. That's right, it's good. Anyway, so it's a little song about that. Before I start, I was in Qantas Club the other day. I was flying to Singapore, and lo and behold, who walks through the door but lovely Colin Barnett, the premier of my state. And I'm sitting there eating pureed dog food or whatever they serve there at Qantas Club, because it's all mushy and colorful. It makes you feel good about overpriced tickets. And so I'm sitting there going, there he is. And I felt very compelled to say something to him. And I was just sitting here, kind of spinning out, kind of going, no. Mental jiu-jitsu. But spinning out at the same time. And I texted my wife, who you just saw play, and she's, you know, a pillar of wisdom, as you can tell by her stories and her words. And so I was like, freaking Colin Barnett is in the room with me. And she just wrote, what the fuck? And I was like, awesome. Thanks for that. And he came so he was in the corner of the room with all his miners. He walked in with like a drove, a whole host of people, and then he sits
there.
He sits right next to me, and I'm sitting there going, "Kid, wow." And he says, "Kid, it's John Butler, isn't it?" And I said, and so I just said, "Look, man, I can't sit here as a West Australian citizen and not tell you how disappointed I am in your decision to go compulsory acquire land, basically steal the land from the Indigenous people and the greater community up there." And we had a good 20-minute conversation, agreeing to disagree. And I said, look, okay, let's just get rid of all the crap for a second, and let's just talk as human beings. I'm a human being, you're a human being, yes, I am a hair farmer, and you're in a three-piece suit, but other than that, we're not different. And I said, no, we're not different. You love your children, I love my children, we want respect, we want opportunity, we want freedom, we want clean air, we want clean water. Imagine if the church that you went to all your life, that your grandparents are buried at, you went there every Sunday. Now imagine that church was being bulldozed to put a gas refinery on top of, say, for example, or McDonald's or something like that. And he just didn't answer the question. So I said, "Look, just here's the question again, if you didn't get it." And I asked him again, and he just wouldn't answer until we just kind of went around circles like we do when talking to politicians. And then he got on to telling me that, yeah, he's going to Singapore to do some business, and he's helping fund 300 Singaporean kids to learn how to swim. And I was like, wicked. That's fucking awesome. I don't even get that, but okay, cool. So that was that, and this is the story. And it goes a little something like this.
So he said, mine, mine. got this hole in my heart and a line drawn in the sand. It's all gray, there are no black and white, so who am I to see?
Levels, and now my cubby's here on stage. I apologize for my cubbies. This is really nice to be able to play like this. I really appreciate you coming and being a part of this. This is wicked. Most musical. In 1958, my grandfather, John Francis Wiltshire Butler, he passed away fighting a bushfire with three other men in a small town called Nanak. And he left his widow wife, Philippa, Greek Bulgarian immigrant, and eight children, the eldest being 10 and the youngest being 7 months old. And he used to play a guitar very similar to this kind of style, and he used to play a bit of lap steel and what have you, and that's an old kind of Irish folk songs. And after he passed away, my grandmother told all her children, her eight children, whoever learns the guitar first will receive this guitar and we'll be done with it. We'll be done. And so for many, many years, everybody tried to learn, but it never stuck. It never stuck. And so none of my aunts and uncles learned, and my dad didn't learn, and none of my cousins learned. And at the age of 13, I got right into, like most teenagers, got right into rock and roll and wanted to play guitar and rock out in my bedroom in my undies with the guitar in my hand. I started learning and broke my arm skateboarding, and that put a stop to it. And then I started again and broke my arm skateboarding on trampoline. definition of dumbass. And then started again, and then at the age of 16, my grandmother could see that it was sticking, and I was going to keep on playing guitar. It was a good friend to me, and on my 16th birthday, my grandmother hands me a guitar that looks very similar to this, and the whole family, and it's like, wow, it's finally happening. So we finally got Excalibur of the Rock, and I got it, and I was like, It came with like a tsunami of memories and emotions and baggage and all kinds of stuff, as you can imagine, you know, eight kids not having a father. And unfortunately, my guitar is not here tonight, the real one, because baggage handlers think fragile means throw the motherfucker. I really wish I could show it to you, but it just happens. I don't know what happens. Very young age, baggage handlers learn the word fragile. If they learn it the wrong way, baggage handler you are. And so he sang this song. He sang this song a lot, and I always thought I'd learn it. My grandma got really sick, and I thought I was going to miss my chance. And I went out, and I learned it really quick, and I raced to her bedside, and we played this song many times, she didn't pass away, and now we sing it all the time together. That's really nice. Looking like a good kick at the ass to get motivated. And we sing it all the time. Anytime I visit her, I bring my guitar, and we sing it literally about 4 or 5 times. And it's fitting. It's a very good song about longing and loss. And this is an old Irish ballad called Danny Boy. Thank you.
Thank you.
to invite a very special guest on the stage. She has given you a whole bunch of soul before. Can you please make her feel very, very welcome, Miss Mama Kenya?
Good evening again. I like how he gets to see your faces. Not the people up there, though. You having a good one? Pretty good, hey? He's pretty good.
No.
He's pretty good.
Let's not do that. This is a song that me and Dan wrote a little while ago, and it's a song called Jenny.
Stroke.
called Mystery Man. It's so quiet. I really didn't need a microphone to do that, but...
Thank you.
All sorted out up there?
Trespassing lands where they don't turn on. All I hear is who were the once were songs.
I got my brothers there to fight in those wars, fighting over scraps and scraping their souls under a blanket of a fighting pride that can't keep us warm from the cold inside. Inside, I'm shaking, baby.
Yeah.
Your prayer is weak. I see. Now I know what's going on. And this next song is all for you. The song is called I Used to Get High. That's awesome. You spend like 6 minutes, you know, putting a lot of effort into a song, and then when it's finished, there's a smile. One time my friend in Maroonum, a small country town, he got caught like this, taking his shirt off. And he stayed that way all night. It's funnier than hell. I hope that doesn't happen to you up there. We just all sat around and said,
Thank you.
Series in like 3 months. She's 9 years old. She's done. Like, my daughter can read faster than me. It's another embarrassing thing. And it's just, you gotta read it so we can talk about it and we can talk about all the cool stuff. And I said, cool, I'll read it. So I'm reading it. Cool stuff. And in the last book I read, there's this thing called a Patronus or something. It's some spell called a Patronus. And basically what it is you have to think of your happiest thought, and the happiest thought turns into something and protects you from all the boogeymen. And so I mid-paragraph, I started thinking, what's my happiest moment? What is my happiest moment? I've never really thought about it. I'm not sure if many of you have, but my happiest moment ever. I hadn't really ever considered it or pondered it, and then I was thinking for a while, and then it came to me that my happiest moments are when I'm with my children and with my wife, and doing the most simplest things. Like, sometimes it's just like camping and playing Uno, or being on the beach, or just real simple stuff. You know, we busy our lives with so many complex things most of the time, trying to get somewhere from A to B, trying to make something happen, trying to get this smoke going. And really, my favorite moments, are just the simplest things. And so this is a little song about that, about just things I give it all away, I give everything away, but it's just a few little things I miss. Thank you. talking. No more stuff. This is the last song. Thank you very, very much for having me, folks. I hope you guys enjoy. It really is. I've been having a really good time on this tour. It's nice to do something completely different where you can take it down to just hearing a pin drop or hearing somebody on acid, one or the other. But it's so nice to do this. You know, I reckon it's kind of rare to be able to, you know, do the trio thing and rock out and get everybody dancing and doing all those rides, and then to be able to do this kind of ride, I feel very privileged and honored that our relationship has that kind of scope. And thank you so much. Thank you. We recorded the first four shows, and it's basically, I just approved the mix today, so we're going to do this quick press, and they're going to be on sale at all the next shows, other than this one. I'm sorry, but we got some order forms out there, so if you dig this flavor of what I do, then you can sign an ordering form and give us your money, and we'll never hear from us again. So, go for it. Danos Direct. Can we get another big round of applause for Mama Kenyo? Can you get that? Thank you. Thank you. I know that seemed like a very long time. But it was a long drive, lots of water. I've written a new song, and it's called Puddle. And it's heaps of water. When I was 21, I discovered open tuning, and that's when I kind of got right into music. Before then, it was just a hobby. And so, 21, I was going to university to become to get my art degree, so I could become an art teacher. And I couldn't guarantee that I'd be a successful artist, but I thought, well, if that doesn't work out, I'll become a teacher, because my art teachers got me through high school, and they were cool cats. So in my first year, I discovered open tuning and just got obsessed. And I started bringing my guitar all the time to school. And then I dropped out. I didn't drop out, I deferred. I'm still enrolled. I'm just deferring. It's my gap year, whatever they call it. And I quit university to sit next to a rubbish bin at the Fremantle Markets to busk. I figured that was a good career move. University to trash. And this song came to me really early, and it was like a mainstay of my busking set. And as I change and as I grow, it kind of grows and changes with me. It kind of says everything I can't say about who I am and where I've been and where I'm going and how I feel about you and how I feel about the love and the kids and how I feel about the war and the crazy ones out there. All the stuff I can't find words for. So I'd like to say thank you again, and I'll leave you with this, and just much love and respect to each and every one of you. I hope you've had a beautiful time. I sure have. Thank you.